was one who started it like 20 years ago. On my sabbatical this spring, I was back in Austin, Texas, and there they had the City Growth Forum, which I started 30 years ago. It's still going. There's a real need for these kinds of intellectual seminars that can bring people from the city government and from local industry together with academics and talk about stuff, and students benefit from seeing all those people in the room together. And I think we're going to see what happens this fall. There's a lot of big problems that are breaking right now in LA, big issues. So we're going to take the seminar down that road, looking at housing as today, and also the issues of transportation issues, and we'll see what else materializes. But there's a lot of need for discussion right now, and there's big decisions going to be made by the voters. There's very little information, so we're testing it on you. And we'll have a good dialogue here today, we hope. So let me just say that after today, the next seminar will be on September 13th, Tuesday. They're going to have a speaker of very high stature who's going to come in. That's me. I will be speaking about related to my paper on peak millennials and how the millennials have risen and are now going to be shifting in LA and other cities. And there's lots of interest in where the millennials go next. And that's the million-dollar question. And beyond that, we will have another housing session coming up maybe October 4th, and we'll have a transportation one coming before that. So, without further ado, let me just introduce what our panel is today. We have a title of a panel. I changed it, actually, in some of the advertising. I said basically it's seeking solutions to LA's housing crisis. And the solution being offered today is by Gregory Morrow on rethinking LA's boulevards, development on the boulevards, a grand bargain between pro and slow growth Angelenos. Question mark. Could it be a grand bargain? Yes, maybe. And discussing it will be Matthew Glesne, who is a city planner for the city of LA. He's the head of the housing unit in the city, and probably knows more about housing plans than anybody else does. And he's better to be discussing. And then we will have some discussion with you. So think about your big questions as you go along. Now, our featured speaker, Greg Morrow, is the Parker Professor in Metropolitan Growth and Change at the University of Calgary in Canada. He's a joint department between the Business School and the College of Environmental Design, where he teaches real estate development, urban design studios, and planning history and theory. He knows LA very well, because Greg has a PhD in urban planning from UCLA, and he also has a couple of master's degrees from my alma mater, MIT, in urban design and city planning, and also another Canadian degree from McGill in architecture and undergraduate degrees. So Greg brings international experience from the same country to the north down to LA, which he knows is problematic. He's also a commissioner, I should say, on the Calgary Planning Commission, and has been actively a participant observer in some of the neighborhood politics in LA as well, is that fair to say?
Yeah.
So I think he brings a really good comparative perspective. We're really fortunate to have him today. And so we'll let him go first, and then after 30 minutes, then we'll let Matt have the discussion. But Greg, the floor is yours.
Great. Thank you. Well, thanks, Del, and thanks for the invite here. It's good to be back. Although I did get my PhD at the school that shall not be named, my wife actually is a graduate from Price in the real estate development program, so I figure that cancels. So I have this unique position where it's between a business school and a design school, essentially, from planning and design. Which allows me to kind of look at issues of urban growth from a multiple perspectives, from a design perspective, planning perspective, from how do the developers think about it, how does the community think about it. So what I wanted to do today is to float some ideas, to kind of look at some history. How did we kind of get into this housing mess a little bit? And then maybe look at some solutions to that. We're obviously not going to be able to touch a lot in the time that we have, but let's see what we can get into, what trouble we can get into. So how did LA end up with this housing shortage? And I know that you've blocked all afternoon off for this talk, so in 10 minutes, let's see what we can find out. But I'm going going to suggest that there is one core belief that is problematic, that has contributed to the housing shortage in LA, which is the belief that land use change, specifically downzoning, can control growth. And I'm going to argue it can't. That land use controls will ultimately determine how much housing is produced, but doesn't control who comes to LA or how or in what form they live. And so that is, I think, at the heart of one of the problems that we face here in LA. So I'm going to show you this thing. This has been floating around, and I said to Matt that this has probably got a lot more press than it deserves, and it's probably his fault. But it's really a diagram. And so what you see are essentially two things. So on the one hand, so it's looking at what the zoning capacity, and we look at zoning capacity, which is essentially how much does the zoning allow to be built, which is a way to measure that is how many people can the city accommodate versus how many we actually have in the city. So you go back 50 or so years, we had lots of extra capacity in the city. You know, the city was 2.5 million, and we do, and there were these estimates produced as to, and of course they are estimates, how many people could be accommodated in LA, it's 10 million. Through the 60s, through the Santa Monica Mountains plan and a bunch of other plans that were instituted, that dropped down to about 7.5 million, which is probably a more fair comparison. So by 1970, and I'm not gonna go into a huge amount of history, but essentially there was a whole series of things that happened in the late 60s here in LA. A citizens committee, a commission that really kind of turned planning on its head. It was a very top-down model in the post-war period up until 1968. And after that point, through this commission, they actually launched the community planning program, which is essentially turning it from something that's centrally planned to something that's planned at the community level. So at that point, they divided the city up into 35 different community plan areas, and it became a different regime. And the discussions that were taking place in the early 70s here, if you were around, were all around what they called rollbacks, zoning rollbacks. How much should we roll back zoning? Because, and this, you got to think about it as well, the early 70s was a period when the environmental movement was just starting. There was very good reasons. People thought, well, you know, we really ought to control growth. And they felt that by rolling back zoning, that would be a way to do so. The City Planning Commission at that time, which was quite citizen-friendly, suggested a 50% rollback. City Planning Department was not too keen on that. They said, well, okay, we accept that you're going to roll it back, and maybe it's a third, not 50%. And City Council ultimately sort of split the difference between those two, and we ended up with about 40%. What it ended up, by the end of, but the way this rolls out, is we see a significant period of downzoning, an initial wave of just downzoning. And then in subsequent community plan updates, what I'm going to show you is that it wasn't so much we downzoned. We didn't downzone at that point, but we downzoned in some areas and upzoned in others. So what happened is you saw a really interesting redistribution of how density would play itself out over the city. So let's take a look at what that is. So first of all, recognize, and Matt may disagree with this conjecture, but I'm basically arguing that LA is planned like it's 35 separate cities. The community plans are the land use elements of the general plan. And so those are essentially the things that matter. And what you see here are three generations of community plans. When it was launched, there was this sort of utopian vision that the community plans would be updated every 5 years. That's how it was actually launched. As you can see, the way it played out was more like every 10 to 12 years. And you notice that this kind of dies off about 15 years ago because not much has happened since. We haven't been updating the community plans. It's a huge process. Essentially, as soon as you get one updated, you're right back starting to update it all over again because it takes that long. So these little black boxes are essentially where all of the community plans were approved in that year. So you can see from the average was about 76, 88, and 99.
So just think about those kind of generations, first, second, and third generation. So by the time the first generation came along here, essentially that was where we had that major first wave of downzoning. Okay? So let's see how this plays itself out. Well, you know, back in the late 60s, Rainer Banham came to LA, and LA at that time was, you know, not cool. And he kind of reframed the argument that said, you know, actually LA's got some interesting, so he talked about the four ecologies of architecture in LA. Now, this is not that, but it's a riff on that. If you think about what LA is, you know, and I'm gonna show you this, and this is just a way of aggregating to kind of make sense of the data. But essentially, whoops, we essentially have four LAs. We have a kind of core LA, central LA, or what I'm calling East Side, East Valley, West Valley, and West Side. And as you go around counterclockwise, it becomes more white, as you can see, sort of from 14 to 25 to 52 to 66% white in a city that is 29% non-Latino white. It also becomes much more affluent. So you can look at the incomes, and you can also look at the densities. It's also becoming less dense. So there are essentially different LAs, essentially. So let's see how this works. So the argument that I'm kind of giving you the answer first so that we can kind of back in and understand how it is. So after that initial wave of downzoning, which you saw in that graph, what we then see is density being redistributed across the board. So what do we see? What is the aggregate of all this? So what I did is I actually went back through, there was over 100 community plans that had been adopted by city council and the various amendments to those through those three generations. And in each one of those, what you're seeing is a reallocation of density. So some things are getting changed from high density to medium density, medium low, medium low one, you know, all of these different designations are being changed. And therefore, what we're doing is we're changing the capacity of that plan area to absorb new growth, essentially. So what I did here, this is a kind of the net result, going from first generation to third generation, how did density change across these four areas? Overall, the city, these community plans allowed for about 10% growth between 1970 to 2000, okay? But the distribution was uneven. So in East Valley, the density was actually increased by 40%. East Side, which is really central LA, 15%. The West Valley was modest at 5%, about half as much as the city overall. And of course, the West Side really stands out because that's not just a lower than normal increase, but it's actually taking density out, taking capacity out. So what that means is lots and lots of downzoning, okay? And this is what it looks like at the community plan level. So black here is where you're seeing increases in density. And you can see it ranges from as much as over 80%, some 50 to 80% here, increases in density, down to reds are the negatives, where the density was actually lowered. Down 25 to 40% in some cases. So that's quite a big difference, right? So in some areas, we're actually downzoning by 40%, and other areas, we're upzoning by 80%. And if you look at this, you could say, well, you know, is that what's the pattern here? Is there a logical way this is going? In planning, we like to think we're logical, and we coordinate land use planning with transportation planning. I mean, if you look out in these areas, these areas other than North Hollywood at the end of the red line typically are not on major rail or transportation corridors. So something else is obviously going along. And why is the West Side downzoning so much? So those were some of the interesting things that come out of that. And why is, so how does this play itself out? I just threw this in here as an example just to show you what happens. So if you take the Hollywood, the much maligned or much litigated Hollywood community plan, the latest update, if you take this area here, and it's kind of a random, I admit, a random spot. I just wanted something that was somewhat close to the metro. So if you look up and you trace how this particular, so if you took, if somebody was going to come along and assemble that into doing a development, just off Sunset. If you looked at the first community plan from 1975, the Hollywood community plan, that was zoned R4, with has a lot area per unit of 400 square feet. So you basically take the lot area divided by 400, and that tells you how much density you can get, how many units you can get, 337 units. By the time we got into the 80s, this was, acute condition was added to this lot. Acute conditions are sort of our way of slipping in changes without actually changing the underlying zoning. Acute condition in this case increased the lot area to 800 square feet per unit, which is essentially R3. And thereby doing is cutting the number of units that you could build in half. In the latest Hollywood plan, which is actually one of the few that actually upzones in places, which is part of the reason why it was sued, this area was actually downzoned further to RD 1.5, which has 1,500 square feet per unit, which means you can now only build 89 units. So this is sort of, I call this kind of death by a thousand cuts, right? This is what we're doing all across the city, is rezoning things so that we can downzone and we get fewer units. So obviously, if this area can only build 89 units versus 337 units, then it can absorb less growth, right? Now just think about this. This is the metro right there. So this is, you know, a few hundred feet within the metro. So this is usually where we as planners like to think, well, that's kind of low-hanging fruit. We want to put density near transit so you can get around in more ways. So why are we downzoning in those areas? Just giving that as an illustration of what happens. So LA, of course, is also changing socially quite dramatically. If you went back to 1960, the city was essentially 80% white, and today it's 29% white. This is largely due to the increase in Latino population. And so we're having these changes socially, but we're also having these zoning changes. Downzoning in some places, upzoning in others, massive initial downzoning. So does that reflect the changing circumstance? So one of the things when you look at that pattern of where things were changing, it becomes quite clear that there are patterns. And one of the things, and I'm not going to get into this, the stats on this, because otherwise you'll fall asleep, but otherwise looking at, we did some regression analysis to look at certain social, physical, and economic factors to understand, are those predictors of the kinds of density changes that we're seeing? And without getting into the technical details, five stood out as being statistically significant, mostly social. So race matters, the percentage of non-citizens matters, the household size matters, and income matters. Those are the things that seem to matter the most. Some of the others, not so much. So the other thing that I did is, because it seemed quite clear that what was going on the West Side was in many ways related to homeowners associations, residents associations, what I tried to do is understand how these things were related in some way. So the city clerk's office has a nice database that goes back to 1980 that looks at all the council record files. And what we did is looked at all the cases in which neighborhood associations, residents associations, neighborhood groups, essentially homeowners groups, interacted, petitioned with council on various things, and specifically on land use cases. And we came up with a decision tree that essentially looked at, you know, how many cases were there, and were they majority land use cases? And so the ones that are highlighted fit the bill. We called those kind of active. These are active communities with respect to land use. So you can see this sort of tracks pretty closely with what we saw before in terms of what was being downzoned. Tayunga's sort of its own oddball on the other side of the hills, but these seven others are kind of form a kind of contiguous area. You'll notice quite dramatic differences between the ones that are the areas that are active on land use matters and ones that are not active. So just in terms of racial profile, very big differences there. Income is about double. Non-citizens also about double. You know, poverty rate, you know, all of these things. So quite dramatic differences between areas that are really engaged in land use matters and areas that are not. And so we plotted out these are scaled to the number of cases that they were involved with. And you can see that there are actually a few number of very big circles here. Those are, there's about 10 neighborhood associations that really were driving the discourse, I guess you could say, around the way in which density should be reallocated. And it was interesting. I mean, there's certainly an effect locally within their community areas, as we saw in the overall numbers. But this discourse fed into broader citywide implications like Prop U in 1986, which downzoned all the commercial corridors. So the pattern is pretty clear. This just kind of calibrates it with respect to population. So the west side had the most downzoning, but it also had the fewest people. So it's essentially a one-to-one relationship between what you see in terms of density change. And this is a kind of weird metric, but it's essentially taking the number of cases and dividing it by the population. So where you have a high density of cases, I guess you could say, not that many people, but for a lot of cases, you get a lot of downzoning. It's just a way of sort of showing that, you know, these folks were very active and therefore won huge concessions through the community planning process. And remember, the planning department doesn't necessarily understand how that's playing itself out. All of these community plans are being initiated and completed at different times. And so the only way that you can really understand it is retrospectively, as I've done. Because how do you know when this area is being planned independently of this, and one started in 1973 and the other one started in 1978? You know, it's one of those situations where it's hard to know until you see it. What's the gist of this? What's the net result of all this? Is that LA didn't plan for enough growth. So if you go back and you add up all of the densities that were allowed in each of these community plan areas over the different generations, we planned for a little bit less than 400,000 people to come between 1970 and 2000. We actually got 880,000. So we have almost 500,000 of unplanned growth. And so when people, you know, in the news now about the Neighborhood Integrity Initiative, folks saying, you know, well, we don't like this idea of you doing general plan amendments, not listening to the community plans. Well, the community plans aren't actually accommodating the growth. So in some ways, you have to do this because the community plans aren't actually realistic. So this gets us to the question is, well, what can we do about this? And one of the things, and this is just one idea. I'm not going to say that there's no silver bullet here. It's ultimately a big suite of things. But I think we need a kind of big idea, something to rally around, something that could potentially be something that is a compromise. But I'm arguing that you can direct growth to the boulevards in exchange, essentially, for stronger protections within the neighborhoods that are in behind those. And this is sort of a solution that nobody will like. Developers will say, why should we be protecting all these different neighborhoods? And neighborhoods would say, well, we don't want the growth on the boulevards either. So, but in a way, you kind of have to get to this point where you recognize that both sides have a point, but we've been doing this game for 40 years, and it's not changed. So what are we going to do differently? And that's why I call it a kind of grand bargain, a recognition that each has a point, but a recognition that each aren't going to get 100% of their ways. So the last time we kind of had this big idea was back with the centers concept in 1970, and the idea was to try to push growth into these nodes. Of course, this was the early 70s, very 70s kind of looking, mega structures and science fiction. Like, imagine the density that LA, is going to have in these areas. I mean, it's kind of crazy. Multiple, not just transit. We're going to have three levels of transit. I mean, it's a little unrealistic. But it was an idea. It was they weren't talking about transit-oriented development back then, but by any other means, that's what it was. It was a TOD strategy to kind of push growth to where we can service it through mass transit. And in a way, what I'm arguing is a similar idea, but recognizing LA is essentially a city of streets. This is LA's circulation system, bazillion streets. We classify them under different categories. So what I'm arguing is there's your boulevards. This is the superstructure of the city. And this is the ability for us to accommodate growth in ways that can also move people around is best accommodated by putting density there on those boulevards. With potentially the possibility of looking at the avenues as well. But collector streets, local streets, the recognition there is that we're not going to try to put a lot of density there. And Matt will tell me why that's bad. So let's take a look at a sample in the West Valley. Now, obviously, I've chosen this selectively because it's a grid out there. It gives you a nice, perfect example of it. But that's what it looks like. And this looks like city blocks, but these are obviously not city blocks. These are many city blocks. These are super, this is the superstructure. So these are 1 mile increments, right? So it would take you an hour to walk from there to there. So it's a huge area. That's what it looks like, right? Huge amount of area. And so what I'm arguing is, let's take all this gray stuff. This is all the neighborhoods that are in behind. People are concerned, this is where people live. This is their neighborhood. They don't want this to change necessarily. So what if we said, we're basically not going to put density in those areas. Keep it as is, preserve it, put in place protections, anti-marginalization, all sorts of things that you can do in exchange for putting density in this area. Now this is where you put both the boulevards and avenues. And you know, the numbers are a little bit off, but you basically get the idea that if you can preserve 90% and put growth into the other 10%, isn't that a better calculus for the city? Isn't it better politically? Isn't it better for us to be able to accommodate? If you just focus on the boulevards, it's even bigger. Obviously, you can accommodate less. But that's the idea. And I want to point to a case in Toronto that is very much adopted this strategy. Now, you know, we always look, LA is its own world, right? We can't necessarily, we're not going to make LA New York, we're not going to make LA most of Europe. These models don't necessarily apply. Toronto is one of those cases which is similar to LA in some cases. So it becomes something that you can look at and say, well, you know what, that actually could work here. So let's see what they did in Toronto. This is a different way of planning. And in some ways, I'm making an argument that we should not go into the hornet's nest that is updating the community plans. What I'm arguing is we should be a lot more strategic. And we should do boulevard and avenue planning. Be strategic plans along the corridors, because that's where we can accommodate growth. Anything else, if you go back into the community plans, it's just going to be this whole debate opened up all over again. This is what they did in Toronto. They said, okay, we're going to look at these major avenues that cut across the city. We're going to use that as a spine, essentially, to think about how we can put density. What are the connections? What are the nodes? What are the edges? You know, how do we think about this differently? And in Toronto, what they did is very much about form. And this is something that I think we can do better in LA. So they essentially said, look, it's very context specific. The height of the buildings depends on the street that it's on. You have a wide street, you can build taller. If you have a narrow street, you have to build smaller. So that's this idea. So it's a kind of one-to-one relationship between the height of the building and the width of the street. I'll get into that a bit more. But also stepping down to transition into the neighborhoods in behind. So that's the fundamental basis of what they're talking about here. 3 meter or 3 story minimum base along these boulevards, but you can go higher depending on how wide it is. Now, this is how they came out in Toronto, but in LA you could say, well, maybe we don't want quite as tall buildings. Fair enough, you know, that can be debated. But if you had a 66 foot right away, you could build a building that was 4 stories at the street and stepped back to 6 stories. That's what they would allow in Toronto. Maybe in LA we say it's 3 stories up to 5. You know, those things can be negotiated. But the basic principle applies. So this is a small avenue. In LA terms, that's a Avenue 3, something like on Normandy or Crescent Heights. then they're, and by the way, the other thing, they also have these profiles that say, you know, this is the angle, and you have to actually step back to three stories on the back. So never, there's never a case where you're, where a building is more than three stories adjacent to housing. And so that's the model that they've built. And medium-sized streets, you get something that's a little bit bigger, maybe up to eight stories with six stories at the front. Again, in LA, maybe we do a little bit less. Up to you. Again, showing the profiles. And then large streets. Maybe it still stays at six stories at the front, but maybe you can add an extra story in the back. And so those are your kind of Wilshire sunsets. So the basic profile is to say, how do we build a mid-rise city along the boulevards and make appropriate transitions to the neighborhoods in behind? So you go from something that looks like this to something that looks like that. That would be the building that would meet those guidelines. This would be a bigger building, something that's quite a bit taller, but you can see what it's doing is stepping back. Right? So you get, you sell these for $1 billion because they're penthouses. The cheaper units are on the bottom, but the basic idea is to try to create mixed use along the boulevards. Okay? There's an advantage, oh, by the way, so these are the step back requirements, all based on sun analysis and how many hours you can get sun on the street. But when it comes up against streets, sometimes you don't have a rear lane. And so they have these neighborhood transition zones, which allow developers to come along and potentially, or, you know, to assemble this. And this is always the challenge, is can you assemble all this? But to create these transition points, put in some rear parking, short-term parking, put in a buffer space next to the houses. So it looks kind of like that. Or like that. And I'm not saying this is great, tremendously great architecture. It's big and bulky. But you get the idea that it steps down to this three-story thing in the back. And you can see this is the typical pattern in Toronto. And it's not unlike LA, where you have just reams of single family in behind some sort of major corridors. And a lot of the time, what do you see here? You see this kind of surface parking. It's kind of low. It's not super high value stuff. It tends to be kind of one story retail. So the idea here is to say, let's focus on that. That's our opportunity to create value and to create and to accommodate growth through revitalizing those areas. And all of that gray stuff, we're just going to not touch. We're just going to leave it alone. It's not worth the political capital to put development in this area when we have all of this underutilized space along the corridors. And why put it in the corridors? Well, first of all, it's a fairly small percentage of the city, so it actually makes planning quite efficient. You don't have to plan, you know, every square inch of community. You just plan along the corridors. So this is potentially what it looks like. Now, you know, again, this is they're putting in, you know, quite a bit of density, and where those meet, they actually allow it to go a little bit higher. But essentially, you have all this single family in behind major corridors. So that's the typical model there. And that I can see that working in LA. It's not that far off from what the way in which our structure of our city here works. And it would look something like that. Medium size, medium scale, five, six stories, four, five, six. So what are some of the implications of doing this? One of the things that happens when you push density up against neighborhoods is you get spillover effects in terms of traffic. You know, how do you manage that? You can have resident parking districts in behind to restrict who can park there. You can also have, and potentially even better, parking benefit districts. This is, I show, this is Old Town Pasadena because it's one of the better examples of that. The idea is you create a district and you try to keep a lot of the revenue from that local. That actually goes into public realm improvements. It gives people an incentive to realize that there's some benefit to having commercial in your community. It's not just going off to City Hall and into the ether, but it actually is reinvesting into my community. This plan about putting density on the corridors really also necessitates, or actually is an opportunity to do streetscape improvements along those corridors to actually create real complete streets. bike paths, wider sidewalks, treatments, all of these things that actually add value to the city. It actually creates more, gives back, essentially. You could have multi-way boulevards, for example, where you separate the through traffic from the local traffic that's accessing all the shops. You could have transit corridors, which have capacity for cars, but it also has dedicated right-of-ways for transit running down these things. One of the, and this is sort of my point, is that the boulevards and avenues serve a regional function in Los Angeles. They are not just local streets, right? And but through the community planning process, they are treated like local streets. So if you get to the border of one community, it changes to something else. So we have a situation where we have a rapid, we have a bus-only lane to the edge of Westwood, and then it stops because Westwood doesn't want to have that, which is defeats the point of having a rapid bus-only lane, right? So the point here is that we have to start thinking about our boulevards as a serving a regional role, not just a local. And I think planning really is about balancing local interests with regional concerns as well. What we've done mostly in LA is concern ourselves with the local without any sort of overall thinking about how the city can function. The other thing I would argue, we've started putting in these RAS zones, which in a way was to get around Prop U. Prop U is written to downzone commercial property, so if we create a new zone called residential, what is it, accessory services? Yeah, I don't know who came up with that. But essentially it's mixed use. Okay, I'm wrapping up. So mixed use, then, and importantly, city initiated. The way it works now, RAS means, you know, if a developer wants to come in and make a change, they can request that, but that makes it much more difficult. So what if we go along and actually do a city initiative? Not everywhere, obviously. Again, it's like Toronto. You have to actually look at the corridor. Where does it make sense to put density and not? The other thing Toronto has are what they call character areas along the boulevards. There's certain areas of the boulevards that, you know, are better, right? They're more contiguous urban fabric. You may not want to lose that. So you kind of you can carve out protections within the boulevard system, but it's a way for you to get a more comprehensive approach. The other thing that's interesting, and it's always an issue in LA, and I think this is the last slide, is the, how do we deal with CEQA? So with the Cornfields Arroyo Seco specific plan, they did something interesting. They kind of did this whole plan, and they created an environmental review impact report for the whole area, right? So instead, the way that we normally do it is kind of project by project. That lot, that lot, that lot, and everything sort of evaluated independently. But what if you sort of look at the overall impact of developing that? So you could think about that similarly with the corridors. You can kind of do sections of the corridor as big chunks and say, look, we're going to review this. So if you put in place the zoning and you've taken care of the CEQA review, then that makes it much more palatable and attractive and feasible for developers to actually come along and do what you say you want them to do, which is to put density on the boulevard. So that these are sort of implementation ideas, but the bigger idea, of course, is to, these are all ideas that are meant to just facilitate that big idea, which is to rethink our boulevards. Great, thank you.
Okay. Hi everyone, Matt Glesne with City Planning. Passing out just a little handout that I'll be referring to. Yeah, I work in what's in our citywide policy section, which deals kind of, we have transportation planners in there, we have a housing unit, we have environmental folks, but we don't do the day-to-day sort of zoning and community plan that you've seen here. So it's not my fault, it's not our fault, that, you know, it's before my time as well. But this is a real honor to be here and to be here with Greg. I'm a huge fan of his dissertation. You guys all should read all 456 pages of it or whatever. It's amazing.
680.
Six, sorry.
Don't do that.
Just a really amazing history of how we got to this place in LA. And it, you'd be amazed that, you know, nobody in the planning department that I spoke to really had any idea of this history. It's sort of sad. We lose our own. We don't understand our own history. We don't know quite how we got here. I'm sure some of the older folks do, remember, you know, going back and how this all began in the 60s and 70s, but this was just a really compelling narrative for me. And, you know, sort of these land use battles are not new, right? We're seeing them today, but they go back. And it's a lot of the same themes over and over again. And it's, I think, really useful to see sort of who wins those battles, who loses, and what loses. I mean, I think what's clear is that housing loss, like the ability to have housing opportunities, was a kind of a loser when we went to this version of from a citywide kind of top-down model to a more participatory. And we all love participation. We're planners. We very much value our community participation. But I think we do need to take seriously that there are potential downsides. There are when you're ultra local and when you are listening to a small group of folks and you're looking just at this particular plan, I think it's quite easy to lose sight of the larger vision and where these cities fit in the scheme of things. And it becomes, frankly, quite easy to just do what a few well-heeled, well-motivated folks want you to do. They show up to every meeting. They write you tons of letters. They write your boss's letters. They write your city council letters. They know exactly what they want. They want down zones in their neighborhoods. And it's very hard as planning to stand up to that and to say that, no, there's a bigger issue here you guys are missing. It's a difficult argument to make on a local basis. It's hard enough to make it on a citywide basis, but I think it's very hard at the local basis. So I think he really illustrated the challenges that we all need to be mindful of. I guess my role here is to be a little, to talk a little bit about just sort of how we see it at the city, but also be a little critical. There's not much to be critical. This is a fantastic idea. Just some other considerations maybe we could bring to the fore. But I wanted to just first allude to these numbers on the chart, which Greg sort of showed the zoning, you know, going down, and what actually happened to our housing unit production. He showed that, you know, growth kept going, population growth kept happening, but housing unit production absolutely dropped off and no longer kept pace with the growth of population. So that's this first chart showing that Los Angeles is actually worst of the top 20 major cities in terms of building housing to keep up with our population growth the last 30 years. So I think that's why Los Angeles, by many measures, has become the most unaffordable city. Our rents and home prices have gone up more in the last 15 years than any other city, according to the data that I've looked at. And I think you know, he's identifying the root cause, and then, you know, it's sort of, you don't build enough, and supply and demand, and next thing you know, you have an unaffordable city. The second chart on here is showing kind of just our housing production numbers broken down by single family and multifamily, the multifamily in the red. You can see, you know, over 2015, we are building more housing than we've built in the last 20, 25 years, actually. So we hit kind of a high watermark of about 16,000 units. But I wanted to show that this is still well below what we were doing even in the 80s, let alone the 60s and 50s and 60s, where we were really pumping out 40, 50,000 units a year. This sort of at a height of a market can't seem to get above 15, 16,000 a year, which does meet our population growth projections into the future. That's the green line. This is the number SCAG gives us, saying LA is going to grow by this much. You at least have to keep up with your future growth. That's the green line, 10,000 units a year. We've actually only been averaging about 6,500 units a year if you look at this 2025 year. So we're not even just keeping pace with our existing future growth, let alone making up for this huge backlog, right, that we've created by this imbalance of population and housing. So I put an orange line on here to indicate roughly what that would be, 20,000 units a year, to actually get back to where we were in 1980, where we kind of had an affordable city, supply and demand in equilibrium somewhat. That would mean 20,000 units a year for the next 10 years. You can see we're not getting that even in our peak year, let alone thinking that we can sustain that for another 10 years. So we've got work to do, and I think this is a really great idea to get us there. I might just say that, you know, Greg showed out, like this planning department, you know, we have our general plan, we have our framework element, and it does pay a lot of lip service to this idea of, you know, transit-oriented development, our corridors. We have this particular designation in our general plan called mixed-use boulevards, which I really think is trying to be what this is talking about. And that's this map on the backside, kind of South LA, the kind of black and white, is showing, this is straight out of our general plan framework element. We have these kind of bubbles, which are centers, like regional centers, commercial centers, but then we have these hatch marks, things along the boulevards that you might see, like going all the way down Vermont, all the way down Western, these hatches. Those are supposed to be something called mixed-use boulevards in our land use kind of diagram. And when you look at what is that supposed to mean, those are supposed to go up to 4-to-1 FAR. Those are supposed to go up to 8 stories in height. This was the plan in 1994 when we did the framework element. The problem is you need to actually do those, you need to do those upzones in the community plans, in the land, in, which is actually our land use element, as you said. So that actually just has not happened. I don't think we've done a great job in, of sort of implementing this idea that we had. I think we were in a lot of alignment with the idea, but then the hard work of actually how to doing the rezoning didn't quite materialize. And so, like, just for example, I'm picking a little bit on my colleague from South LA, that this is pretty much any plan you could look at, but the color diagram right next to it shows our latest draft released last month for our plan in South LA. And these kind of areas highlighted in green at the nodes, those are really the upzone areas. And you see we're upzoning at intersections primarily. These nodes, these transit nodes, this is where the rapid bus might stop. This is where there's maybe a train stop. We don't carry that down through the corridors. So it really is, it goes, you know, it's about a few properties in from most of the major intersections, but not going all the way along the corridor. Which is sort of in orange, but the orange really is not changing. We're not changing. We're not doing any really upzoning along the majority of the length of these corridors. So I just wanted to show, you know, again, that it's sort of the plan, but putting the plan into reality is a separate thing. And I mean, I've got some ideas of, you know, why that's difficult. And there's a lot of reasons. I think you know, I actually just talked to the planner. I'm like, why didn't you upzone the corridors? Greg says we should. And you know, her response was multifold. There's multiple reasons, but you know, number one, we're planners. We don't kind of like these one size fit all. We like to, you know, look at what's going on in this section of the corridor, this section of the corridor, that section of the corridor, different heights, of course, different neighbors, different concerns, some, you know, historic issues. So a lot of variables that I think work against sort of a really clean, nice, simple concept like this from gaining a lot of favor with our community planners. There's also things that I think are important that, you know, when we do a plan, and people don't, I don't know if I didn't realize this at least, when we do a plan like for South LA, we have kind of a number we have to hit in terms of our upzoning or downzoning. And it's based on our SCAGs population projections. And they break it down and say, South LA has been growing this much, it's gonna continue growing this much. Okay, you've gotta have enough capacity for that future growth. So we kind of upzone generally until we hit that mark. And then anything upzones after that mark becomes, oh, now you're bringing growth, you're inducing growth to the area for CEQA purposes. And so there's really no incentive to, once you've sort of hit your upzoning through your nodes and through your intersections, to go much further and go along the corridors. You now have to begin explaining yourself in CEQA, and you have to say, well, why this is a good thing and why there's overriding considerations. And generally, I think it's not that we don't do that. I think we've done that, but it's a real barrier that I don't think I really realize that there's like we sort of have these targets, and we think we've done our job when we've hit them. And CEQA works against trying to think and actually address housing issues and trying to address supply issues and be a little more aggressive. You know, there's also things like just the way it was explained to me is our commercial corridors often have small lots. They're not big enough. They don't go back far enough to really give you a lot on these, especially when you consider there's usually a single family home right behind you and you have to worry about the transitional height. And we've done some modeling. You don't get as much as you think if you would actually just do a corridor. So I think that's an issue. There's maybe just a couple other, just minor, just in terms of just like conceptual, this being an approach, and it has, again, so many upsides to it. But one downside that I have heard is you would just, and you hear, you know, from housing advocates, as anytime you sort of propose an upzone, is you're just going to give it away. You're just going to give away the density. You're just going to give developers and not ask for anything in return. And I think that's motivated because today, you know, we have no money for affordable housing. We're not building enough affordable housing. And density bonus is the one way we can create affordable housing in Los Angeles, in the state of California. And that kind of requires you to have something to bonus on top of. In other words, if you give developers sort of everything that they need and give them their six stories because that's what they want to build, they can't go any higher than that because of construction costs. They're happy at six stories. If you zone to six stories, they're never going to get a density bonus. You're never going to get affordable housing. And so just a minor quibble there is that's something that we hear oftentimes when we're going with an upzone plan. And there are, of course, ways to structure that and to build that in. It's not at all a fatal flaw. I think you could build something like that in. Another concern, and it took me a while to sort of grasp this, is there's some criticism of just sort of, I've read some criticism of Toronto's approach, actually being so arterial heavy, so focused on the corridors that they have sort of done this grand bargain and left the neighborhoods alone. And while that gives you, I think, redeveloped boulevards and does, there's a very good logic to it, as Greg pointed out. But one of the things it does do is when you leave the other areas alone, all the residential areas within the corridors, it's a huge opportunity you've sort of left on the table, right? You know, as he showed with that Hollywood map, you know, you're still, you know, 600 feet from a metro station, but you're going to leave that alone? I mean, I don't know that you're exactly proposing that, but that is, you know, I think there are cases to be made for areas, you know, residential R-zoned areas that are not on a boulevard to also not get a full free pass or to think about, you know, things we often think about. People often also say that the most affordable housing in terms of like construction costs are not these podium buildings on the boulevards. These actually carry a fairly high construction costs and they're sort of geared towards a certain kind of lifestyle, and they're not terribly family friendly, you could argue. A lot of people make an argument for, you know, what we really need to do is an alternative, kind of a completely 180 degree view, is like we need to actually go into our single family neighborhoods or our low density residential areas and just moderately uptick them a little bit and allow more, you know, missing middle, allow the duplexes, the triplexes, the up to six units, that's actually affordable. That's like, and it's for families and it's like more livable and it's like the construction costs way down, you don't have to build elevators and all this kind of stuff. And you know, if you allow that way up in Pacoima or way down in South LA, that's actually the most kind of affordable housing as a strategy. So I'll throw that out there. That's just something I've heard. I don't, you know if anybody's got any real proof one way or the other, but that's kind of an alternative. Finally, I'll just close by what we are sort of doing in the city of Los Angeles. I showed you what South LA is doing in terms of the nodes, and I think that it does, that's kind of our community planning approach. It seems to be into the future. But what can we do kind of at the citywide level or more systematically? I think we are looking at the density bonus program as being the place to make these kind of reforms. Already our density bonus program has a TOD incentive where if you're 1,500 feet within a defined transit stop, or a rapid stop, a light rail stop, you get to kind of double your FAR if you're on a commercial corridor. So we sort of already have this. We have RAS, which you mentioned, which is like this zone change process. But we also have this density bonus incentive to get you up from 1.5, that's the FAR that nobody wants to build at, that's the Prop U FAR, up to 3.0, which is something more buildable. We have that built into density bonus. You know, you do a bit of affordable housing. We want to really build on that and expand that. And we know that'll be a struggle, but that you know, elongated along the corridors essentially is exactly what that would be. You know, it's 1,500 feet today, that's not very far. You could easily go to, you know, half mile or something like that. And then you really do have most of kind of the core corridors covered by zoning that actually you can build on. And you get the affordable housing built in, and you know, density bonus is great because you could do all these other kind of incentives, and it's proven very workable in Los Angeles. Developers seem to like it a lot. We get a lot of production and get our mixed income in places that often don't get mixed income. So we think like doing this through density, basically it's a version of it doing it through density bonus could be one way. We also, those RAS, we get quite a lot of these. These are zone changes that private developers say they don't want to go through density bonus, or they're not in with 1,500 feet. They want to go bigger. They have to apply for this RAS zoning, this zone change. We're thinking of putting in something called a value capture program that would basically say that, hey, you bought it at this zoning, now you're asking to double or triple your density. You're not doing density bonus, you're not doing affordable, there should be an affordable component based in that. And so we're thinking about how sort of there's anytime you're sort of asking for more, there's sort of an affordable housing requirement there. We are looking at CEQA. We're doing a lot of CEQA streamlining when these plans are done. They are going to have the ability for projects, if you meet the plan, to tier off and do CEQA and have CEQA handled. Parking is getting a lot better. density bonus. The other good thing about density bonus is if you're in a transit and density bonus, the parking is really been radically reduced. There's a law called SB 744 passed a couple years ago that really is nice for the parking issue. So we think all these things kind of go together, and you know, affordable housing, transit are all best friends, and we want to kind of keep all those together. I think I'll close with that. The last chart that I didn't explain is actually showing how much we've been building on commercial zones, and it has, Greg, you don't have it, but we've gone up. We've actually, you know, it's from around like 30-35% 15 years ago to now 63% of all housing units being built is on commercial zones. So this is happening, does appear to be a fairly robust trend, and I think for all the reasons that Greg mentioned, there's just so much to be said for this. These boulevards are underperforming. They really do need to be redeveloped. We drive around. I mean, it's a low hanging fruit. It's a very obvious place to start. I think my only pushback is we got to even be more ambitious. It's maybe that's the first step, but we need to think even bigger to face this challenge we're in. So thanks so much.
So hold your questions here. As convener, I get to ask the first question. First a comment. A fabulous idea, very clearly presented, low-hanging fruit. I mean, in a historical context, I really can see it, and I really like your criticisms or your reality checks they're doing there. So here's the specific question for both of you. And Matt, question formulated, and you started to actually go to it a little bit. So Greg, your idea is trying to figure out a political bargain. And yet there's also, on these corridors, going to be a real cash value question about the price of land. As soon as we do densify those corridors or make it known they can be densified, then the value's going to go up and the landowner captures the value, and then how do we get affordable housing out of that? So I'm thinking, okay, I'm not going to ask this question. But then you alluded, Matt, to value capture as being something going on, and maybe you could explain that, but then I want to know here, how's it work in Toronto? What do they do about that? And you must have had this, you teach real estate development, so you've got a solution too. So give it to us. How can they get affordable housing out of this without raising land prices too high?
Well, I would just say there's two issues, one of which is the number of housing units for very low income households, which is what low income housing, or what affordable housing is. But that's only one part of the problem. The part of the problem is that nobody can afford Los Angeles. And so there's a donut effect, right? So we do have mechanisms to produce for 30% or lower, or 50% or lower of area median income, even 80%. But we don't actually have the production of middle income housing. So there's that. The idea of affordable housing is not mutually exclusive of the idea of producing a net supply of more housing, period, which is sort of what I'm arguing. So that can be layered on top of this. I'm actually working with the City of Calgary right now on precisely these questions of value. How do you actually value the bonus that you're giving landowners by granting entitlements? So there's one, but there's also the other bonus by putting in new transportation infrastructure. So we're looking at actually both of those things actually add value to the thing. But these are tools to essentially create community benefits. So affordable housing is a community benefit. Streetscape improvements are community benefits. And also, it's a way that we're looking at to upgrade the infrastructure that's necessary to even support this. Mm-hmm. Program. So those things are all part and parcel of how they're doing it in Toronto as well. And I would just say, you know, in Toronto, so I've presented this as a sort of big idea, you know, let's just do this. It's not necessarily a one size fits all, and it's not one size fits all in Toronto either. They are planners too. They like their, you know, community engagement, and they get pushback and all of these things as well. And so the idea isn't so much to think about it as a one-size-fits-all, but to think about it as we need to reorient the way in which we think about planning to where we can practically put the density in ways that actually will help facilitate moving people around as well. So that's part of the challenge, is that if you put density everywhere, A, you're going to have the hornet's nest, as I sort of said, you know, you're going to put density in your neighborhood. Oh, what? No way. So that's the political problem, but it's also a practical problem, because how do those people get around? If you spread density all over the place, does that actually create enough capacity and density right where you need it along the corridors to move, to actually justify new transportation infrastructure? Because the problem is people don't want density because traffic's bad, right? So if the solution is to put density in combination with transportation upgrades, then, and at the same time, not get into the whole political debate about, I'm gonna go into your neighborhood and start screwing around with it. So in Calgary, one of the biggest issues, it's kind of amazing, is what we call secondary suites. Here it's accessory dwelling units. So this is absolutely minor increases in density, but as soon as you say, you know, we're gonna allow secondary suites or ADUs in your neighborhood, wow, do people ever come out of the woodwork? So, you know, that's my point, is that I think there is a compromise. And I agree with you, and as my planner, agree with you that, you know, yeah, the problem is so big that we need to do more than just this, but I think it is the low-hanging fruit. This is a first step, and there are financial tools that can both generate new affordable housing, but also the tools to actually do the streetscape and infrastructure and transportation upgrades to make it work. So I've answered sort of three. Yeah. I've taken your question and answered three others.
Yeah, and I mean, I think I didn't mention that, the land value. I think that is kind of where I was going in the back of my head. I do think if you.
I
mean, it's not true value capture. If Richard Green was here, I think he's got an article kind of talking about an auction-based way to what is the value when you upzone and you're adding transportation infrastructure, there's a value placed on that, you could auction it off, and that's what happens in Latin America a lot. That's like sort of true value capture. And I love that idea, and I'm I don't know if anybody in America's ever done that, but we have density bonus program in California, and it seems to me like just sort of work within that, don't undermine it. And then if you're making a choice to go around it and get density some other way, well, there should be some other thing that sort of, you know, captures you. But I want to be very clear, I'm a YIMBY. We don't want to stop housing development. We don't want to do anything that would sort of disincentivize, because we need, the only thing that's going to really make LA more affordable for everybody is to build more housing for everybody. So the last thing you want to do is add too many requirements that sort of stops housing. So that's not what I'm suggesting. Density bonus pays for itself. It's been a very sort of lucrative program, so we think it's a good model. I'll leave it there. Yeah.
All right, so I don't think there's any questions, though, either. Oh, there's one. Bob Harris from Architecture.
So I really enjoyed the presentation and also your comments. In regard to the strategic plan, it seems to me the right kind of plan for a city. And a strategic plan having as one of its major elements the boulevards. And I thought we had that as a part of the 1992 general plan.
It is on paper. Those little hash marks.
It's not ever implemented.
Never, you know, disconnect between plan and implementation.
Well, the strategic plan probably has more than one element in it. If the boulevards are one, and so we're going to talk about streets, I wonder whether it also includes sort of hierarchy of street types. Because if we got to the hierarchy of street types, we'd find some others that were better for the housing that we're talking about, for more affordable things, and for nodes of activity within the neighborhoods, not the boulevard kind, but.
Yeah, I mean, we have that. We have local collector, you know, Avenue 123, you know, and Boulevard 12. This is sort of a big idea to say, look, you can't do everything, and we need to rally around one.
Get started.
Let's get the big stuff out of the way. My experience is that the smaller scale stuff that's in the neighborhoods ends up being less affordable. You know, when you think of sort of the small lot projects, they tend to be even more expensive. But more expensive than apartments on boulevards, I'm saying.
And of course, there's some other elements, open space and other kinds of things.
Sure.
So I'm just starting, the question really is based on an idea that the magic of the city is choice. So you really come to a city because of more choices and one kind of remember what you're looking for. More job opportunities, more educational opportunities, more possibility of finding somebody who might love you, a variety of things that make you come to a city. And so it seems to me what's really great about the Boulevard idea is that for the neighborhoods in Bethany, they suddenly have more choices than they ever had before. They can walk to things, to services and restaurants and other kinds of things that weren't there before. So there's a traffic dimension of that.
Well, I think that's a great point. I mean, that's the biggest challenge we face. 80% of the trips are essentially convenience trips, right? So it's not so much where people work versus where they live. That's a challenge. But, you know, if we can get past the issue of density in general, then you start to realize that by doing this approach that Toronto's doing, it actually does add value to those communities in behind, because it does mean that you all of a sudden have shops, restaurants, everything within walking distance. You can cut down on traffic, not only the people that are moving to those locations, but for the traffic that's being generated right now through the singles that are in behind.
So Matt, I wondered whether the critique that you provided about things to also think about has helped if we start to think about, in fact, the whole matrix. I'm with you, Greg, about the importance of the Boulevards, and focus on that with regard to planning. Seems to be really clear. But things are going to happen in the neighborhoods in any case, and there's going to be the need to sort of figure out what to approve and not to approve and what the planning is. So strategies at the next stage must also be necessary if this is to work. I don't know if that's right or not.
That's a good point.
Question here? So I also really enjoyed the presentation. Thank you guys for taking the time. I had a question as it pertains to the developers from a long-term strategic point. Low vacancy rate and high rents is really their ideal scenario. So from a strategic standpoint, why would they buy into this? Hey, let me build a huge number of new complexes in order to ultimately reduce prices. Why would they buy into that?
Well, individual developers don't. They're not thinking, well, the overall market, if we produce more units, then the marginal price of what I sell it for is going to go down. It's not that direct. They have a project. It has a certain timeline. They're pricing it under the current circumstances. That's how they underwrite it. So I don't know any developer that would think that the general increase of production of housing is bad for their business. I think that they would think that's good.
Yeah, our city's so big that you need to drop in the bucket, right? Anything they build won't matter. It'll add up over time, but they won't see it as part of their calculation.
But assuming we're going to try, I mean, based on this chart that you're showing, we're not even getting anywhere close to the number of units that we need to be building, right, to accommodate some of the backlog that we've had. So assuming everybody was to kind of get on board and try and pursue this agenda, I feel like long term they might be shooting themselves in the butt, in the foot.
It obviously does get to a point where it's no longer profitable. You know, if the market crashes so low, you know, there's a certain point.
I'll be glad to get to that point.
Yeah, me too.
Okay, another question.
Another question regarding your proposal. Potentially downzoning or keeping the zoning of these single residence neighborhoods. Right? So my first question is, what would you do with the current zone in these neighborhoods? Most that are, you know, RD3, RD1.5, R5, and would you propose downzoning them to R1?
Well, I didn't propose downzoning them. I said to protect them. Which is not quite the same thing. You can put in, so for example, what are some of the things that people are concerned about? To what extent, it also depends on the neighborhood, right? Because some neighborhoods are already at R1 and some are R3 with R1 product sitting on them. So those are the situations you could look at, but I think you need to look at things like anti-mansionization, things like that people are concerned about. So I'm not talking about downzoning, I'm just talking about not upzoning.
Well, the latest drive, the latest trend in Los Angeles is to downzone. If you look at the specific plans passed in June, you saw a lot of lots in South Los Angeles that went from RD, you know, 30, RD5 to RD, I mean, to R1.
As I've shown, you know, the general trend has been to downzone. So I think if we keep those neighborhoods flat, I think we would have done very well. And upzone along the boulevards, that's the strategy, is to say we're not trying to put density into your neighborhood. Whatever's on the books now is whatever it's going to be, for now.
Let me go to the back row, please.
As we all know, LA is rezoning, and we're developing an entirely new zoning code, and we're just beginning the multifamily component of the code. And one of the discussions that we've had a lot, and Matt's been involved in these, is that the mixed-use model that we see in LA is imported from elsewhere and is not really a good fit for LA. We see a lot of required retail space that isn't leased, for example. And a lot of the discussion has been about, well, what is a better mixed-use model that would be a better fit for us? And I just wondered if you had any advice. Does Toronto have any building typologies that are unique to Toronto that maybe could fit for LA? Or are there other, I think in Canada just does this better in general?
Well, I think there needs to be empirical basis for making decisions. So when I hear, you know, mixed-use doesn't work in LA, that immediately makes me think, show it to me. Show me that that's
any building by Jeff Palmer.
Well, I wouldn't even call that mixed use. Okay, so that's like the lowest of the low, right?
This is where we're focused.
Wait, it's nail salon.
I don't know.
But I'm sort of looking at my experience, you know, along Fairfax and other areas where. Even in the Valley, we're seeing it as well, along Ventura, where, you know, that model works actually quite well. It's not going to work everywhere.
Right.
So,
right.
You know, that's, and Toronto's strategy is, once you start to say, okay, the basis is going to be, we're going to look at the corridor. Mm-hmm. And we have to look at how that corridor changes and morphs over its length. Because essentially what happens is different communities adopt it as their main street, and then the next one does. So this kind of zoning might work here, and it might need to be slightly different here. So it isn't a one size fits all. I want to kind of emphasize that. It's a framework for understanding what, on a big scale, broad strokes, where we should be putting our efforts. And, you know, all of it, we know cities are hugely complicated. We know there's going to be applications coming in all over the place, even in residential areas. But I think as a city, we need to say, you know, we need to be stronger in saying, in pulling out those boulevards, which your colleagues are looking at in the context of a community plan or a kind of local area, and saying, well, what is the bigger picture? And the same thing goes for Skaggs projections. Well, okay, that accounts for future growth, but it doesn't count for the backlog that we've already got. So we'll never get there as long as we just use the Skag projections, because it doesn't say, okay, well, how are we going to solve the 500,000 people that we haven't actually planned into the city? So I think that it can work. I think you need to be sensitive to the context. And you know, as I showed you in one of the illustrations, you know, it is, the zoning does go up and down. So where you have two main streets essentially coming together, then you do have more of a node there where it comes up. And as it gets further out and into more suburban, quote unquote, areas, then the typologies do change. The buildings aren't as tall. Even if you're allowed to build as tall, the market's not going to create that. So I think it's certainly doable, but I think we need to have an empirical basis to say, you know, it doesn't work in LA. I would say, just based on the examples, you know, the Palmer buildings are not great examples.
No, they're horrifying. But you know, the planning department is why those buildings have retail space in them.
Well, okay, so that's a different issue. And I think that's something, and I do that as it's one of my big beefs on Planning Commission as well. We, as planners, we like to put retail everywhere. And the reality is retail is the delicate flower of development. It requires a lot more units to support that than we think. So we have to be a lot more selective in where we put it. And I think what that means is, and they've thought about this in the Toronto cases, is that not all of those boulevards are going to be retail all the way along. So what does the form look like when it is purely residential at the ground level? What they do actually in those cases, they still require them to build a taller first floor on the basis that it could come back and be convertible into retail into the future. So it just requires a little bit of thought and care about how the guidelines are written. So I think it's doable, but you're right. The point, the bigger point is correct, that it's not a, it can't be just a one-size solution.
Okay, so before we thank the speakers, I just want to say a final comment. This is about as good as it gets. We really can't promise that every growth seminar is going to be as good as this. You have a big concept, you have good graphics, you have good expertise, and we hope for that. We're going to have high-speed rail coming to LA. I hope it's good. Like this. We're going to have the millennials and where they're going. I hope it's good. We're going to have another round on fixing the housing crisis as well. But this is an excellent start, and I just want to thank you guys so much.